Now, come to think of it, all the animated movies, VFX we have seen, some things never change. For instance, there will always be dirt, there will always be ground, trees, things in surroundings like walls, shelves, books, bridges, flowers, moth, street lamps. I can count maybe 100 more things right now, but basically what I mean is, doesn't matter how unique these fictional animated worlds are, there are still so many common elements. That's simply because there's a limit to what human can think living in the physical rules of our universe. And not just that, even within a single animation project, there's so much to create, so much to think, which would be waste of time if made from ground up every time. So no one has the time to create things from scratch when dealing with bigger projects. So what do? When a project kicks off, we follow the art and then start collecting the resources. So these will be tools that will help you create trees, mountains, procedural assets, some tools just to populate the books on the shelves or the traffic on the street, people in the town, or some tools just add smaller details like moss, etc. And if there are no tools available for your need, then you might have to invest in one if your project heavily depends on it. So instead of tweaking models for every project, we can make procedural assets, which would be useful in not just the current project, but the future ones as well. Now, procedural workflow also allows you to work with confidence in non-destructive workflow. So in case something doesn't work out well, you can always go back and tweak few things in the node tree and rest of the system will automatically adapt to it instead of literally adjusting everything manually. Unlike the simple modeling or working with the modifiers, procedural workflows have the ability to communicate within itself and output result based on the rules that are set in the node tree. So for instance, let's say a sentence describes there will be more grass where it rains more, or you can say there are more trees around the river. So thinking from the beginner's point of view, how will you approach this kind of scene? So I think you probably will start making a ground plane, maybe sculpt an area for the river. And then maybe with the help of particles or something, there will be a weight paint which will help you distribute the trees. So basically you will make one ground plane and then one tree, and then manually you will have to sculpt this river area. So there are three different things. So let's say if something changes, or maybe it's a different location where the flow of the river changes, then what will you do? In that case, you will probably have to sculpt this area again and redistribute the trees and do the entire work again. Basically, manually placing the trees or the weight paint and do all those adjustments. So this is not a system. This is like you literally spoon feeding the software with individual information, like this is the ground, and this is the ground, these are the trees, and then weight paint. So there's nothing exciting about that. So these are like old methods. If you're working on bigger projects, then you probably will end up wasting time with this kind of system. So instead of that, what if we could make a very simple system? So this is the most simple example, actually. So we will talk about the geometry node, how to make this in geometry node later. So what if we could make a ground plane, and on top of that, in the node tree, if we could assign an object which will make a river. So let's say if I make a spline here, and if I tell this node tree to pick up this shape of spline, and wherever this spline falls, the influence area of this spline will mark the area as river. So this area, so let me just bring one color. So this area will be now called river. So you will basically set an attribute for river. So in future, whenever the shape of this spline changes, let's say if you change the shape of this spline and make it like this, then the river will change accordingly. And so this one attribute will be called river. And then in the node tree, you tell this node tree that wherever the influence of this river stops, from that point onwards, rest everything will be marked as forest. So then you'll assign a different attribute. And these areas on the ground will be automatically called whenever there is any change in the shape of the river. Other than that area, rest everything will fall under that attribute called forest. So now you have two attributes, river and forest. So instead of manually weight painting, you are basically making a very small system which can, with a single input, it can drive the whole output. So now when we bring the trees, so instead of manually doing a paint job on the weight paint, so what we can do is we can assign the trees and link that with the attribute. So if next time when I bring the trees, we can tell the trees to align wherever the forest attribute is. So next time when you bring the tree in the node system, it will look for this attribute and will avoid this attribute and will automatically make a dense area out of trees. So now if I in the next scene, if I change the layout of the scene, let's say if I make it a diagonal spline or something, or within the scene if I make any changes, so what will happen is the influence of that spline will automatically mark the area for these attributes like the forest and the river, and the placement of the trees will be automatically assigned. The distribution will happen automatically, basically. So this way, so let's say if you have like 15 more locations, or in future if you have a different scene in the different project, if you're dealing with a similar kind of situation, then all you will have to do is load up this node tree on any other ground object and it will work exactly the same. It will mark the area based on the shape of the spline and distribute the foliage or the trees accordingly. Investing a little more time on this procedural system is worth more than doing all that work manually from ground up every time. And this is the most basic example. We will talk more details as we move forward in later chapters. So this was a slightly intermediate example. Now, thinking from beginner's point of view, what is the most basic thing you can create with the geometry nodes? So how about making a three-point lighting for the characters? Now, some might would say this is a ridiculous example. Now, why would we do that in the geometry nodes? Now, for example, how many steps are involved in creating a simple turnaround? You will have to create a three-point lighting and then make a 360 animation for the character. Now, however simple it is, it's 5 minutes job. So what if you could record that entire procedure node group and save it for the future purpose? So whenever you have a character, you can simply load this node group and it will bring a three-point lighting, a ground object, and also make a 360 nice animation for you. Now, if you think harder, you might be able to figure out 10 more things which can be made with the nodes, can be reused to save time. Another example, how about an exploded view of an object which turns into holographic wireframe and then assembles back? I think that should be possible with the geometry nodes. So in simple words, now that you have upped your game in the animated content creation and you really want to take the animation seriously and take on the bigger projects, the two things you would need to add to your kit: adding non-destructive workflow. You should be able to make things with confidence without having to worry about limitations of the undo or the uncertainties of design changes in the future. Anything you make in the bigger projects should be procedural, so that, let's say if your client says, I don't want a bird in the logo and instead I want a marshmallow, so you should be able to make those changes in the logo and without having to worry about the rest of the animations and effects that you have applied on that logo. And number two, making reusable procedural systems. Like I mentioned before, instead of doing manual work, start thinking a system which can save you time in the future. A digital asset can be made and purposed beyond the scope of the current project, and getting used to making procedural systems instead of starting models will help you save time and stress less on mundane works and leave more room for the creativity. So imagine having a library of your own digital assets like trees, buildings, books, etc., whereby just tweaking few numbers you can change the look of it. Houdini is known for its procedural workflow and powerful digital assets, and nowadays more and more programs are adapting to the node-based procedural workflow. Similarly, Blender's geometry node is beginning in the similar direction as well. And in this short introduction series, we are going to cover absolute basics for the beginners and end this series by creating this short animation. And the animation is very simple. Any model that I bring in will be split in two parts, one golden, one silver, and some small round shapes would emit at the partition line, and also add simple wireframe, which would construct one side of the mesh. So I made this in simplest way one could make without overloading first timers with information. Also, at some point, if something is really not working in geometry nodes, and if you are really stuck, do not get frustrated. Reason could also be that the feature is not fully developed. So don't blame yourself. It could also be a bug or incomplete feature. So just check the forums if you get stuck at some point. So let's begin with the basics and start understanding the interface of the geometry nodes so we can have some common ground to discuss the future tutorials. I'll see you guys in this video. Click right here and let's jump to the next chapter.